Hi guys, welcome back. So you want to print faster, better, and with less failures. Today, we're looking at upgrades and why, in most cases, they can jumpstart your 2D printer. I'm Richard, and this is Reprinting for Money, the channel that helps you make more money with your 2D printer. The 3D printer market flourishes off upgrades for your 2D printer, and it's quite easy to spend hundreds of dollars and matters of minutes. But are all upgrades needed? At a certain point, there is a point of no return where you spend too much on your 2D printer for what it can deliver, or too much time making all the upgrades work with each other. I have some heavily modded machines in my farm, but all serving one or more purposes. In my experience, depending on the level of your 2D printer, there are some mandatory upgrades and some that can be easily bypassed. Let's face it, cheap printers are, well, cheap printers. The goal of 3D printing companies that sell cheap machines is to flood the market with their printers, and to bring down the cost, they cut corners. Understandable. But it leaves you in a hard position if you want to push harder your machines or want more reliability. As I said in this video, you don't want to spend your time becoming a 3D printer mechanic, but a 3D printing business owner. Let's see some upgrades I recommend based on my experience. The number one upgrade for many printers is going to be the extruder. The solely goal of a 3D printer is to lay down plastic, and possibly consistently. If you have extrusion issues and printing jams, this will be the best upgrade you can buy. If most of the medium to high-end printers have good extruder mechanism, many entry-level printers have extruders not meant for intense use and tend to wear fast. My best two suggestions are the Bontech BMG or the Arbiter. If you don't want to fiddle too much, there are complete drop-ins like the A3D Hemira, the BQH2, and MicroSwiss Dual Gear Direct Drive. Great solutions, but you will have to see if your 3D printer can mount them. Upgrade number two, build surface. If the extruder plays the major role in pushing plastic, the surface has equal important task to allow a good first layer adhesion, and once finished printing, an easy release of the print. There's quite a debate on the best build surface, but also here we can look at what trustworthy companies are doing. Most of them are shipping their printers with spring steel coated PEI surfaces. Why? To keep it short, PEI sheets has the best adhesion and release properties in the same piece. Many materials stick very well to PEI and once cold, release with a pop. Second choice would be a glass surface, awesome for mirror-like bottoms. Also, upgrading your build plate usually allows you to get rid of small ditches in your 3D printer bed. Cheap 2D printers sometimes are shipped with warped beds and leave the owner to figure out how to manage it. I have an Artillery X1 that comes with a 300x300 glass surface, and over time it warped due to heating and cooling cycles. After I slapped this PEI spring steel surface, I obtained a perfectly straight print surface. If you still have warped bed issues also with a new print surface, you can install a BL Touch to get perfect first layers. So yeah, for awesome first layer adhesion, first a PEI print surface and then a BL Touch. Upgrade number three, cooling. It will be very cool if you liked this video for a YouTube algorithm. Had to put this joke here. Once upgraded the extruder and the surface, you are in a situation where you can push your 3D printer harder, meaning that you can push higher volumes of plastic and increase printing speeds. When you're printing at faster speeds, you will need a better cooling solution. Most printers ship with a 4010 blower, and even if they're okay, when printing fast, especially PLA, a 5015 blower is preferred. Having more airflow allows you to freeze melted plastic in air, resulting in better bridging and overhangs. Installing a better cooling fan usually means you will have to design new pieces or scout the internet for already made parts. This is why I always recommend to get a printer with a big community around it. Probably that piece has already been designed by another user, saving you some time. Besides these three major upgrades, in my experience, I didn't see gigantic improvements with further upgrades on the hardware side. These three upgrades alone will put your machine at a reliability level hardly obtainable by stock machine. Unless you buy a Prusa, they already have all these pieces from factory, so yeah. You can install a fancier hotend like a Volcano, a Mosquito, or a Dragonfly if you can find it, linear rails, 0.9 degree stepper motors, new ticker belts. I mean, if you enjoy modding your 3D printer, go for it. The machines are yours and you can do what you want. But don't go down an upgrade rabbit hole, draining too much energy from your business. More parts you change, more money and time will be required to get all the things to work together as an ecosystem. Not to mention you will make further changes to slicer and firmware. Talking about firmware, most of the machines on the market run some version of Marlin. Marlin as a mainstream firmware is very good to make printers print. A halfway upgrade for your firmware will be Octoprint. That allows you to control remotely your 3D printer and adds many features. But a real firmware upgrade will be Clipper, a rising 3D printing firmware getting quite traction thanks to easy firmware tweaks and quality retention even at higher speeds, like 150 and 200 mm per second. Running a 3D printer with Clipper through Mainsail OS or Fluid is a great way to optimize 3D printing time with faster speeds and control remotely your printer without being in the same room. In the next video, I'll show you how I rigged up my printers and control them remotely, cutting production time in half. For today, that's all. See you in the next one.